Good evening, Chicago. Welcome to another evening of conversations on the Russ Meeks Speaks show. I am Dr. Brandon Hamilton, your moderator. For the past 20 years, the Russ Meeks show has originated by Dr. Russ Meeks, has been instrumental in giving the community a much needed voice about social, political issues and empowerment of people. This episode then continues in that tradition. And so I'm joined by Dr. Lou Agosta, PhD from University of Chicago. Dr. Agosta is an author of three books on empathy. So this show is actually titled How Empathy Makes a Difference to Organizations. He's also a consultant who advises organizations and individuals on how to expand their empathy. And he delivers custom empathy training to organizations and individuals, helping them to deal with reducing conflict, improving productivity, and generated expanded business results. And as if that isn't enough, he teaches at Rush University Medical School. So before my friend Dr. Agosta starts to talk, I want to lay a little bit of groundwork for you. When I was studying for my doctorate, I looked at a number of management scholars. And when we first, the two of us, talked about doing this show, part of me wanted to start with, perhaps Maslow and his famous issues of empowerment and motivation. However, as we talked amongst ourselves and I got to rethinking it again, I was turned on by Charles Bernard. So you'll see the relevance of why I picked him. Charles Bernard lived around the time period of 1886 to about 1964. Some people see him as the father of organizational theory because of his famous book, The Functions of the Executive. But I see him as maybe creating a systems approach to organizations. And so when you look through some of his development, it's kind of interesting. In the earlier days, he was very scalar, and he looked at eventually moving into coming up with a responsibility about 1950. His priorities shifted a bit then, and then he shifted again in 1955, where he started looking at morality, business morality. The thing that a lot of people remember about him is the debates that went on about individuality versus collectivism. Okay, I think he remained in the mindset of many people as a individualist until he passed. So let's look then at the organization of social systems then, and I submit to you, the viewing audience out there, that his fundamental thesis in that famous book is that organizations are an economy conditioned by organic states of the structure, and it's outside of the systematics of delegation and control. In other words, it's a organized cooperative system of policies, procedures, etc. The other thing in our title leads to a little bit of a discussion about leadership and power, so we won't spend a lot of time there, but when you look at some of the theories of power, like legitimate power, coercive power, referent power, expert power, and reward power, we're not going to look at all of those. Legitimate is power that is perceived that where someone has the right to persuade behavior. So you'll see that entering into our conversations a little bit. Coercive, I think the audience understands that one. Referent power, if you're not familiar with it, is where you're influenced by loyalty, respect, friendships. You'll see that very relevant today. Expert power is the other one I mentioned. That has a lot to do with past experiences and knowledge. And then finally, reward power. That's allocation of incentives, like a promotion or proposals. The other thing in our title of this show is organization. So there are simple organizations. There are functional groups within those somewhat simple organizations. There are divisional structures. Strategic business units you might hear from certain management scholars. There's a more fluid structure called matrix, where the span of control goes across divisions. And then some people recognize about holding companies. You know, that's quite another one. So with those frameworks in mind, those frameworks of literature, we're gonna bring my friend Dr. Agosta in, and I'm gonna start off with saying, Dr. Agosta, how do you define empathy in a corporate business environment? And while you're at it, is it different than the empathy that occurs in the home, in the school, or in politics, or in the street? You know, that seems to be something that you might have help us with.
I can be helpful with that. And what I want to say first is, hello. I acknowledge your empathy, Dr. Hamilton Brandon.
Thank you.
And I am honored and delighted to be here. This is really great, a great opportunity that we could have this conversation. And I get your question. I was listening. Best practice, define our terms up front. What the heck is empathy? And how does it play in all of these different environments, at home, at school, in the workplace, in the community, as the community is out there? The short definition of empathy is that it's a way of getting data about the experience of another person. Mm. And within that, the longer definition within that is that in empathic receptivity, I'm open to the experience of the other person. I then take that as a vicarious experience, like I get the movie of your life. You know, we were talking earlier how you were living in Gary, Indiana, and the city of Chicago is visible across the lake. Oh, it's not the Wizard of Oz, but it's almost like the Emerald City. And would you know, your commitment was to accomplishment and contribution, and would you ever get downtown?
Would I ever get there, yeah.
You know, many people, I mean, and so that gave me a sense of who you were. And so you take that vicarious experience and then process it in empathic understanding, empathic interpretation, and there you take a walk in the other person's shoes. That's the folk definition of empathy. Okay. What's it like to be in your shoes now, but not necessarily with my feet?
Yes.
But where does your shoe pinch you? That's the key. That's not easy to do. And finally, in an empathic responsiveness. So that's like the first part. You know, there's a lot there, and we're going to talk more about that. But the second part is like, well, is empathy different for a parent or for a boss or for a teacher or for a doctor? This is what I would say as concisely as I can say it. Empathy is empathy. Empathy gives you access. And who I'm dealing with, if I'm in business, I'm dealing with customers. I want to bring my empathy to the customer interaction. If I'm a parent, I'm dealing with, you know, a child of tender age, a 9-year-old or a teenager. That takes a lot of empathy,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
If I'm a doctor, a lawyer, a professional relationship, and how I get inside the experience of the other. Does that answer your question?
That's a very good start, Dr. Agosta. Lou, we're friends. I guess we can call
each other
Brandon and Lou. Yeah, that's a very excellent start. I'm glad that you framed it in something that I can recall. You're very accurate there. I have distinct memories of waking up and looking at the vision of the skyline, the beautiful Chicago skyline, and wondering if I would ever get to play in that arena. And later, as I attended the University of Illinois, same thing. You know, from almost every place in the campus, you're looking at the loop. So you're very accurate about your assessment there. Let's continue the dialogue, Lou. In your opinion, does the phrase corporate entity, you hinted a little bit about the corporate approach versus the community approach versus the family approach. So let's stick down the corporate alley for a while here. So do you think that corporate empathy makes sense? Is it a contradiction of sorts? I've spent a lot of time in corporate, and sometimes I have felt that maybe certain of my colleagues weren't empathetic. React to that.
Well, is corporate empathy a contradiction in terms? No softball questions here. The truth of that statement, I would say, you know, I'm not going to be a consultant, but we're going to look at the trade-off. I don't want to answer it depends, because that's like an easy way out. But here's the truth of that very confronting statement. Sometimes the things that make us good at business, dealing with the competition, solving legal problems, dealing with information technology issues, dealing with employee crises, client crises, some of those things that make us good at business don't necessarily expand our empathy. That's the truth of, is corporate empathy a contradiction in terms? I believe it is not.
Okay.
If one were to take empathy out of corporations, the businesses wouldn't work very well. Money, revenue, everything is by the numbers today, in a sense, including empathy. Although I'm going to be confronting myself. I have been known to say things like, we don't need additional data. Oftentimes, we need expanded empathy. But in the bigger picture, you know, we need both.
We need both.
The numbers, and we need authentic human relatedness. So the trade-off with that very confronting idea is that, no, corporate empathy is not a contradiction in terms. It's an assignment.
Okay.
Human beings, I'm going to do the empathy training in 1 minute. I'll give you the empathy training. And it won't be complete, and it won't, you know, it won't, it'll be fuzzy around the edge.
But it's the cliff notes, yeah.
To train empathy, to expand empathy, and people debate whether that's even possible, right? But I assert that it is. And to expand empathy, drive out cynicism, denial, drive out shame, drive out devaluing language, drive out devaluing behavior, bring in authenticness, integrity, and empathy naturally shows up. People want to be empathic. Drive out cynicism and shame, which is kind of the statement, corporate empathy is a contradiction in terms. That's a deeply cynical thought.
Yes.
It's not that there's not some truth to it. The world is a cynical place. Get ready, you know, get cinch up one's cinches,
yeah,
and be ready to engage. But drive out these negative things, and people naturally are empathic.
Okay. I'm hoping the audience understands the conciseness and the completeness of that response. But hold your horses. We're not done. We're gonna drill down a little more about that. Recall that I talked about the various business structures, the simple,
yes,
the functional, the strategic business unit. But I'm going to drill down now into the matrix and holding. Matrix is a business structure where a manager may borrow from different divisions for a particular project. And so they have people in their span of control, yeah, just temporarily.
Yeah.
And then they go back to whatever functional unit they originally came from. And in holding, company is rather similar in the sense that it may be a large company that owns a number of other companies. So
yeah,
there's a lot of variety in the people that they may have to interact with. With those two frames in mind, talk a little about those corporate structures,
yeah,
how it relates to empathy.
Yeah, let me say this. I'll try to net it out here. If I had to choose a corporate structure that is most open to the possibilities of empathy, it would look something like a matrixed organization.
Yes.
Where, why do you say that, Dr. Liu? Well, one reason is empathy is about crossing boundaries.
Ah.
Doing so with respect, with recognition, with acknowledgement, with, you know, you've got your job to do, and I'm not trying to tell you what your job is, but in a matrixed organization, the opportunities for teamwork are important and on the critical
important
path to success. Now, in a holding company, opportunities for teamwork are also important.
Yeah.
And in any of the organizational structures, here's the thing, I would actually push back and disagree with what I just said, if you can imagine that. There's a spectrum. It's because the empathy is on a spectrum. And the empathy is where you find it. Hierarchical organizations, which you mentioned earlier and didn't really ask me about, but
yes,
there's room for empathy in them also.
All right.
I mean, it makes sense in some organizations to manage as a hierarchy. It works best, customers expect it, workers expect it, executives know it, but it doesn't mean that executives don't stop and listen.
Yes.
I mean, their input from employees is always important, is always on the critical path. And organizations that don't merely give lip service,
yeah,
to engaging in the delivery of value are the ones that will succeed in all kinds of challenges. So I don't know if I've really answered your question. In a sense, you know, it's like be ready for empathy to show up wherever two human beings, an executive and a worker, co-workers, are engaged in delivering values for customers.
I think you were telling me a little while ago there's plenty of empathy to go around.
Thank you for that kind of like lead-in. What I actually was saying is I don't know if there's plenty of empathy to go around. There's enough empathy to go around. You know how we can feed everybody on the planet? Thanks to agribusiness and green revolution, there's enough food on the planet Earth to feed everybody, and people are still starving. They're starving in the Middle East. They're starving in Africa. Heck, they're even starving in our own communities, which is really a scandal. And we don't feed them because of politics in a negative sense of the word, because of human misbehavior, human badness. Well, just like it with empathy, there's enough empathy to go around, and it's badly distributed. On any given day, you may say, my goodness, you know, these guys may usefully, men or women may usefully expand their empathy as they encounter homeless people, or you know, I'm thinking first responders, or customer service. I mean, this is where it shows up in business, the training of the customer service. And so that's a wonderful lead-in, because I don't want to say, I don't want to approach somebody and say, in effect, there's not enough empathy here. That's an insult.
Yes.
What is it? You know, Dr. Hamilton, Brandon, we need more empathy here. That implies you lack empathy. On a good day, I may expand my empathy. On a good day, you may expand your empathy. Yeah. But that's like saying something that I don't really want to say. You've got empathy, but the challenge is to take it and expand it. I mean, and I know you are very rich in empathy. This is not just to lay it on thick for the interviewer. I mean, because I know you personally, and you know, there's a warm relatedness with you that that lives. And so I'm just not going to go.
But I'm glad you're throwing that out, Lou, because you did make me flash back a bit to where I first became a CEO when I got the MBA. You know, we talked a little bit about bottom up empowerment kind of management theories, because one of my professors was the famous Ed Lawler from the Center for Creative Effectiveness there at USC, University of Southern California. So that was one of our professors. We spent a lot of time talking about this. And I had come from an autocratic family, you know, where everybody was, everybody of senior or parental function was coercive, you know, so I didn't understand, and I'd have spent also 6 years in the military, so I was used to this very top-down pecking order kind of thing. So as a CEO, when I got out, I found myself confident about looking at data like other CEOs with the framework of solvency, liquidity, and profitability. So if the audience can bear with me, let me take you to this chart. For instance, I wanted to give you a sense of what I was talking about. I know you can't look at the details of it, but up at the top here are some common ratios that CEOs look at that are all liquidity. So there's like working capital, how much cash do we have to cover our debts, you know, how many times the inventory turns is this one right here. So so liquidity gives us a sense of how quick we turn our money into cash. So there are certain things that you do in your business to always have a sense of your liquidity. This next group is solvency, and it gives you a sense of how long you're going to be in business. Very important measures as a CEO. Right at the top of it is the debt to assets. So for instance, you want to keep your liabilities about 60% of your assets. When you start getting above 65%, 70%, you're a target for hostile takeover. So those are the kind of things that they train you in MBA school. But I want to call your attention to this bottom one here, profitability. This is extremely interesting, because without me going through the details of every ratio, many of them have asset on the denominator. As a matter of fact, there's asset in the denominator of some of the ones I just went over in liquidity and solvency. So back in those days, I kind of saw an asset as strictly the hard assets, but I think I'm wrong there, Lou. You know, Jack Welch said in a famous Financial Times interview about the global crisis of 2008-2009, where we had that crazy, embarrassing real estate debacle, and I'm quoting now, on the face of it, shareholder value is the dumbest idea in the world. Shareholder value is a result, not a strategy. Your main constituencies are your employees, your customers, and your products. Wow, that seems like it's in your wheelhouse of what you've been trying to help us understand here, Lou. Compare and contrast the possibilities of empathy now in this environment that he's hinting about.
Well, I will. I mean, and you've put a lot of things. You have put a lot of things in the space there, Brandon. Mm. And I acknowledge that, and I'm going to work with that. So I'm going to riff on a couple of them, including that great quotation from Jack Welch, who says, you know, shareholder value is overrated. This is after. I wish to say I honor Jack Welch. Unlike you, I don't know him personally or a friend. I'm not a friend of a friend.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, in terms of business transformations, he's one of the geniuses of modern capitalism. Nevertheless, he made that statement after he got his $417 million bonus. So it's pretty easy to say, hey, man, shareholder value is a little overrated. He had enough money to start his own school, which MIT and a number of other big name MBA schools picked up on, even though the school itself remained a rather modest contribution. And the challenge with that, the challenge is that he transformed the company he transformed, GE, and was an innovator, and he invented something called rank and yank.
Rank and yank is not
going to actually be the number one contender for the empathy award. It consisted in ranking all of the managers and executives and relative to one another, not absolutely, but relative to one another, and eliminating the bottom 10% every year and amply rewarding the top 20% every year. This he became famous for. This is now called, among other things, management by the numbers.
Yes.
Now, here's the tough thing. I'm sitting on the sidelines. Hindsight is always 20/20. Empathy is an essential feature of anyone who has customers, anyone who has coworkers, anyone who has clients, anyone who has stakeholders, because that's what shareholders are.
Yes.
And he points out, I think, very accurately in that quotation, that businesses are rewarded for delivering value, not for money in the narrow sense. That the reason people trade and exchange their hard-earned dollars, and most of the people I know are, you know, working pretty hard for the money they make, whether it's a lot or a little, anyone is going to expect value coming back, and that means it solves a problem for them. It gets them breakfast, or it gets them transportation, or it gets them an education for their family, or it gets them a good place to live. And so the values which human beings appreciate and the things that make human beings flourish and do well and have lives that are meaningful and rewarding are what business contributes. So in that sense, you know, what I have said may be a masterpiece of studied ambiguity, because I want to point out where maybe the empathy falls a little bit short. There's room for expansion. There's enough there. But here's the kicker. Here's the real kicker. He's a public celebrity. He's a public CEO. He's a celebrity executive. And he had, it's in Wikipedia, three marriages, mm-hmm. right? You think there might have been a cost and an impact for the innovations that he had to go through in transforming the companies and inventing this hard-charging, as it's called, what is it? Alpha A-type personality.
Oh, right.
There's a cost and an impact for that.
Let's take a digression, if you don't mind, Lou. When I started earlier to talk about the various ratios and variables on the chart that I showed the viewing audience here, this chart right here, I got to thinking just now about also intelligence quotient. That was another thing that was brought out when I became a CEO. I went to a number of webinars and seminars about that. But then as I met you a year ago and we started to learn more about one another, I was introduced to a term called empathy quotient.
Yes.
And I went on my own and did a little homework. I gave myself a research project. And a name, Belinda Palmer, just kept coming up over and over and over again. Who is this person and what is this intelligence quotient? I mean, empathy quotient.
Well, no softball questions here. And I want to say I am not Belinda Palmer's spokesman. I acknowledge her. She is an innovator in business. She's branded herself. I mean, it may be, so here's the humorous moment. We can talk about the relation between empathy and humor. The thing that's really missing in my life is that my name is not Belinda Palmer. Why? Because she's presenting her consulting practice, she's presenting to Google. She has branded an empathy quotient index, I think I get the terminology right, yes, in which she ranks the top 100 companies in her, this might be worth talking about just a bit.
Right.
I mean, now steel mills are not on the list, and defense
well, a lot
and aerospace
of them were technical
companies,
if I remember right.
Well,
that got my attention.
In 2015, the top three contenders were, LinkedIn, the social networking company, which gives you LinkedIn for free, Microsoft, and Audi, the automotive. So
yes,
there's a mix there.
Okay.
The critique is most people, what is she measuring? This is the challenge. If you ask the person on the street, now this is true regardless of Belinda Palmer or not.
I mean,
and you know, basically the consulting is, well, how do I get my company to move up in your survey?
Yes.
That's worth knowing.
Yeah. If we like your index, how do I improve upon it?
You know, that's the angle, which is saying, you know, anyway.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, if you ask the person on the street, and I did some data work on this, the average person will say that empathy is compassion.
Okay.
They will tell you a story about charity or intervening to help somebody in need or altruism. And heavens knows the world needs more compassion. It is distinct from empathy.
Ah.
Empathy is a method of, a way of data gathering about the experience of the other person. And what I do with that experience, what I do with that information is up to my professional standards, up to my morality, up to my ethics. The challenge with a number of the surveys, I think we haven't really gotten that quite right, although I acknowledge sometimes
there's room for growth.
The innovators are the ones with the arrows in their back, so to speak, because they get, and then I get to sit on the sidelines and critique them. Nevertheless, the challenge there is empathy is different than carbon footprint.
Absolutely.
But carbon footprint is a part of the data that she wraps up. Empathy is different than social responsibility. By all means, we need companies that are socially responsible, and empathy is different than that. So that's a short version of the critique. It definitely gets my dander going if you bring this up.
And I
do want to say, I mean, I really honor the work she's doing. It's so important. She's also about female empowerment, women empowerment.
Yes.
And one of the criteria is the number of women on the board of directors. And as the father of a grown-up daughter, I think you may have one of those too, I am in favor of female empowerment, and I'd be in favor of it even if I didn't have a grown-up daughter.
That brings up another memory I want to share with you, Lou, and the viewing audience. As some of you have seen me on the show before, know that I have a master's in business as well as a doctorate in business. And in the MBA program, they talked a lot about getting on a board, you know, after you finish your MBA, and let's say you're the CEO for a while, where do you go from there? And the answer was serve on a board. And so as I started serving on the board, they were all men at first. Almost every board I was on, there were nothing but men. And there's a certain panache, a certain behavior, a certain way of dressing, all of that. And then after a while, I started to notice women leaking on coming on the boards. And wow, the dynamic was very, very different.
Yeah.
When I worked on my doctorate, a lot of my classmates were not only female, but some of them were older, some were very young, some were from the Middle East, some were from various countries in Africa, you know. And so I started to see, once again, a need for a new framework in my mind.